You all know Nemo. Nemo, the small clownfish from down under. You know when he got lost? When he got caught by a diver? Remember Marlin? Marlin, his father. He went on his quest finding Nemo. But do you also remember Bruce? Bruce the shark. You remember Bruce the shark? He was chairman of the fish-friendly sharks society. And he kept telling himself, fish are friends. Fish are no food. But Bruce was wrong. And today, I will give you 5 arguments why Bruce was wrong. Today, my talk will have nothing to do with sharks. Everything to do with fish as food. But first, let me go back to some 2.5 years ago when I became the head of a research group working on aquaculture and fisheries. Well, aquaculture is where we keep our fish in contained areas. Fisheries is where we send our fishermen to sea, where we catch the fish for us. So as a new head of the group, after having worked for maybe 25 years on fish health, I went to a world conference on aquaculture. And I was sitting in a small room, as scientists do. We were sitting there, a little bit sweaty, and there were some policymakers. And I was listening to the people in this room, and they were discussing how to deal with the public perception of aquaculture. They were discussing how to deal with intensification, with pollution, with fish welfare, fish diseases. And I was listening, and I was a bit surprised, because I heard this story before. I heard this story before when it comes to livestock, when I read my newspaper at home. And I was surprised because in the Netherlands, we moved on. We moved on. We look at livestock in a context of sustainability, of circularity. Well, circularity is something I would like to come back to, and I would like you to remind me to come back to circularity. Thank you. So first, let me go back to Bruce, and why Bruce was wrong. Bruce was wrong because he didn't realize that 70% of the earth is covered in water. 70%. That is a lot of water to grow fish. And there's large worldwide organizations that keep telling us we need to double, or maybe even triple, the production of fish to feed the growing world population. So why do we need to double or triple the production of fish? Because we also realize we cannot sustainably catch more fish from our seas and oceans. So why does it have to be fish? Well, here it's important to realize that fish, think maybe of an Atlantic salmon, but it's not unique to an Atlantic salmon, can also be a rainbow trout, can also be a pangasius. Fish can convert their food into protein very efficiently. Imagine maybe a fish can eat a kilogram of food and convert this into almost 1 kilogram of fish. And they do this much more efficiently than do livestock, than does a pig or a cattle. So if you want to feed the growing world population, you have to think of fish. We like to refer to this as the Blue Revolution. The name comes from the Green Revolution when we managed to multiply the production of crops. So that was my first argument. My second argument is that fish are healthy. Think of oily fish. Think of tuna. Tuna is a fish species that is used in Japan a lot. People in Japan are known to grow very, very old, and they have a diet that consists of fish and fish products. So fish are very healthy. And even better, when your fish is grown in aquaculture, then you know where the fish have been grown, and you know what they've been eating. So actually, you know that they are safe to eat. My third argument. Fish are green. Not literally. If your fish is green, then please do go back to the fish shop and buy fresh fish. No, fish can be green from an environmental point of view. So imagine you are living in Europe and you go south. During the holidays, you want to see some sun. So you go to South Italy, maybe Greece, and you like to eat sea bass or sea bream. Fish species very popular in the south. These fish species, but again, not unique for them, also tilapia in Asia, they're grown in what we call open systems, in nets in the sea, in this case, the Mediterranean Sea. And as long as you don't keep these fish in too high densities, the surplus minerals, the waste produced by these fish, are simply diluted in the environment. We have alternative systems, we call them multi-trophic systems, where we combine fish with seaweed and with shellfish. So the minerals produced in the feces of the fish are used by the seaweed to grow. The seaweed can be used by the Japanese to wrap the sushi. And the shellfish are natural filter feeders. So think of an oyster or a mussel. And those leave the environment even cleaner. Another example. These days, we move the production, the aquaculture, from sea to land. And we call this recirculating aquaculture systems. And in these systems, we can heat the water with solar energy, with wind energy. We recirculate and we can reuse all the waste products. So we are in full control of the environment. That was my third argument. So now my fourth. And for that one, I would like you to relax for a moment. So please take a relaxed moment to sit in your seat and imagine yourself to be a fish. You are swimming in the ocean. You are with thousands of your best friends. And from your birth onwards, you can eat and you can do whatever you like. You can go anywhere. You can choose your preferred food. You can choose to swim in a school, but you can also choose to swim solitary. You might even meet the occasional shark. So your whole life you spend in your own preferred environment. Last argument. Stay relaxed, please. I'll take you to aquaculture. In aquaculture, you are in a contained area. So that means I protect you from predators. You won't meet the shark. When you have breakfast in the morning, I provide you with a meal full of vitamins. When you have your evening meal is full of protein, fatty acids to make you grow strong and healthy. And at the end of the day, when sadly maybe you do have to be caught and eaten and slaughtered, I will make sure that when you are slaughtered, I do it in the best possible humane way, because your welfare is my concern. So now I've just given you five arguments why fish are food. And now, thank you very much. I would like to come back to circularity. In a circular approach to livestock, for example, we aim to not lose any minerals, any nutrients. We like to reuse our waste products. We like to combine all these and make sure we don't have any loss. We like to think local. And why don't we also do this for fish? I've mentioned a number of fish species to you today, but I haven't even touched on the variety of fish species that we can catch or that we can grow. I've mentioned a number of production or catching systems to you. I haven't even touched on the diversity of those. So I haven't even managed to outlay for you the full diversity of life underwater. I call this diversity in blue. Why is this important? Because diversity in blue will allow us to customize our circular approach. It will allow us to combine the green and the blue. Why would we take a different approach? So, in the end, why not combine the two? Why not, when I go to a world conference on aquaculture, why not make me proud to say, I am the head of a research group that studies aquaculture and fisheries. So remember, circularity. Remember, diversity in blue. But above all, remember, fish are food.